It may not appear as imposing as the walls of the Kremlin. It may not be as Hollywood-friendly as the columns of the White House. News coverage consistently portrays it as an unassuming black door distinguished by a number 10. Nonetheless, number 10 Downing Street is one of the vital centers of executive power in the Western world. As the official residence and workplace for the British Prime Minister, or PM, this house has been the backdrop to key decisions that have influenced national and global policy, economy, as well as the destiny of the UK in times of war. We've already covered the life and times of some of its occupants on our sister channel, Biographics, and in today's episode, we're going to focus instead on the history of one of the world's most significant buildings, and we'll find out how Number 10's occupants work hard and party even harder. The earliest building known to occupy the site of Number 10 was a brewery, which fell into disuse in the early 1500s. In the second half of the century, this was replaced by a private house owned by the Crown. In 1581, Queen Elizabeth I leased it to one of her favorites, Sir Thomas Conyver, the man who later arrested Guy Fawkes after the failed gunpowder plot of 1605. After the death of Sir Conyver, the house went to his niece, Elizabeth Hampton, who happened to be the aunt of Oliver Cromwell. Thanks to this connection, Elizabeth lived undisturbed at the future Number 10 during the upheaval of the English Civil War. And despite this connection, she was not evicted when Charles II restored the monarchy in 1660. The lease on the house expired in 1682, and Charles II handed it over to George Downing, the guy the street's named after. Downing had been ostensibly loyal to Cromwell during the Civil War, but effectively was a double agent who had favored the return of King Charles and was promptly rewarded. He was granted rights to tear down the pre-existing building, which he replaced in 1684 with 20 terraced houses. These were designed by famed architect Christopher Wren, but Downing had them built as cheaply as possible on a shallow foundation. The last private resident who lived at the terraces was one Mr. Chicken, who moved out in the early 1730s. You could even say that he flew the coop. In 1735, King George II presented the Downing Terrace and an adjacent larger house to Sir Robert Walpole, his first Lord of the Treasury. Walpole refused to accept these properties as personal gifts, asking the king to make them available as official residences for him and future Lords of the Treasury, a position that eventually took the name of Prime Minister. The two buildings were connected and refurbished by architect William Kent before Sir Robert moved in on the 22nd of September 1735. His successors apparently didn't care much for the house, as they either snubbed it altogether or were removed from office after barely 2 years. The next Prime Minister to take an active interest in the building was Lord Frederick North, in office from 1770 to 1782. But what really matters here is that North dedicated serious time and effort to improving his official residence. He added the distinctive checkerboard floor in the entrance hall and made the front door iconic with the addition of the overhead lamp and the lion's head knocker. More importantly, North secured almost £1 million in today's money to fix the cheap foundations originally laid down by George Downing. But it was only a temporary fix, as Number 10 Downing Street would suffer from structural problems in the future. By the early 19th century, most prime ministers used Number 10 only as an office, preferring to live and entertain in their private houses. In 1827, Prime Minister Viscount Goderich employed architect Sir John Soane to give a facelift to part of Number 10's interiors. Soane delivered by creating the elegant wood-paneled state dining room and small dining room. Despite these efforts, Goderich's successors continued to snub their official residence. The problem was with the surrounding area. In the first half of the 19th century, it had grown seedier and seedier. A census of the time recorded 170 brothels and 145 gin parlors in the area. One wonders how Her Majesty's ministers could get anything done. The ministerial residence continued to be neglected until February 1874, when Benjamin Disraeli took office. Disraeli renovated the entrance hall and other public spaces with government funds, but he refurbished the private rooms from his own pocket. He was the first to install a bath with running hot and cold water at the price of £150. That's almost £20,000 in today's money. His successor, William Gladstone, had even more cash to splash. During his tenure, 1880 to 1885, Gladstone installed the latest technological marvels of the era, electricity and telephones, and he spent £1,555 in furniture, which is more than £228,000 in today's money. I guess he didn't go for the IKEA stuff. Thanks to Disraeli and Gladstone, good old Number 10 was ready to face the brave new world of the 20th century. But how would it cope with two world wars? Prime Minister Lloyd George moved into Downing Street in December 1916, slap bang in the middle of the Great War. After forming a war cabinet, he reasoned that his ministers needed a constant flow of statistical data to function. To ensure this, Lloyd George expanded his staff, so much so that the building soon ran out of room. As early as January 1917, the new staff had spilled into the back lawn of Number 10, occupying a village of wooden huts known known as the Garden Suburb. When the armistice was declared on the 11th of November 1918, jubilant crowds poured into Downing Street, chanting LG, and the PM, LG, made an appearance at one of the first floor windows to salute the crowd. Almost exactly 20 years later, another prime minister celebrated peace by addressing the public from a first-floor window. It was September the 30th, 1938, and the PM was Neville Chamberlain. Following the Munich Agreement, France and Britain had acquiesced Germany's goal of annexing parts of Czechoslovakia. In exchange, Chamberlain had secured a peace agreement with Hitler, or so he thought. The crowds in Downing Street looked up at Chamberlain as he reassured them about the radiant future of their nation. "My good friends, for the second time in our history, a British prime minister has returned from Germany, bringing peace with honor. I believe it is peace for our time." That illusion lasted around 11 months. On September the 3rd, 1939, Chamberlain sat in the cabinet room facing a BBC microphone. As he went on air, the PM announced that the UK was now at war with Germany. On May the 10th, 1940, Chamberlain resigned his post and was replaced by Winston Churchill. Churchill and his wife Clementine moved into number 10, but by October, they had to move out due to something of a nighttime nuisance, the Luftwaffe bombing London. The couple moved to number 10 Annex, a secure apartment next to the underground war rooms just off the Foreign Office. Nonetheless, Churchill continued to use Downing Street to conduct his work and eat his meals. As Churchill recalled in his memoirs, on the night of October the 14th, the PM was having dinner when he suddenly became acutely aware of the vulnerability of the 25-foot window. He stood up from the dining table and ordered the kitchen staff to go to the air raid shelter. 3 minutes later, a German bomb hit the nearby Treasury Garden, and the shockwave severely damaged the kitchen. The PM had saved the kitchen staff, but three civil servants died in the explosion. The official residence continued to suffer only indirect damage throughout the war. Winston and Clementine Churchill moved back to number 10 near the end of the war in Europe. On May the 8th, 1945, the PM delivered his famous Victory in Europe broadcast from the cabinet room. The indirect bomb damage, however, had worsened pre-existing structural problems. The Ministry of Works completed a survey in 1954 which revealed that number 10 suffered from subsistence and sloping walls. The report was ignored until 1957 when PM Harold Macmillan formed a committee to address the problem. One of the proposals was to raise number 10 to the ground and erect a new building. The eventual solution was less dramatic. Architect Raymond Erith was charged with strengthening the building's structure. Erith found that floors, columns, and foundations had rotted and needed replacement. Moreover, they discovered that the iconic black bricks of the facade were actually yellow. Decades of pollution had darkened the original bright color. Erith did the only thing possible. He had the facade thoroughly cleaned and then painted it black. The next PM to oversee significant changes within number 10 was Margaret Thatcher. She did not carry out structural works, instead focusing on modernizing its IT and communications infrastructure. In 1982, the first direct hotline between number 10 and the White House was put in place, followed by the installation of the first microcomputer and a reader for microfilms. In the early 2000s, Tony Blair launched a new wave of upgrades to the residence. The Blair administration modernized the communications network by inaugurating a dedicated video conferencing suite designed to facilitate coordination with other world leaders after the 9/11 attacks. The PM then authorized a widespread program of structural and cosmetic improvements, as well as tackling accessibility and sustainability issues. These reforms were continued by his successors Gordon Brown and David Cameron. The former introduced a system to harvest rainwater, while the latter's staff achieved a 10% reduction of carbon emissions by 2011. In February of the same year, Cameron appointed a new member of staff in charge of solving the escalating issue of vermin. This new aide was recruited from the Battersea Dogs and Cats and goes by the name and title of Larry, Chief Mouser to the Cabinet Office. Larry is not the only staff member in charge of protecting number 10 from unwanted guests. Remarkably, security measures at Downing Street have always been surprisingly light and discreet. In fact, up until the tenure of Margaret Thatcher, Downing Street was completely open to the public. The PM's residence was guarded only by two police officers. During Thatcher's years, increased terrorist threats from the IRA, the Irish Republican Army, prompted the Home Office to apply a second level of security. Two gates at both ends of Downing Street, where teams of officers would screen visitors. This didn't stop the IRA from attempting an ambitious strike. On February 7, 1991, the faction parked a van in Whitehall Road, from which they fired three mortar rounds. One of the shells exploded in Number 10's back garden, narrowly missing the cabinet room, where PM John Major and his ministers were discussing the First Gulf War. The bomb left a crater in the garden and broke several windows in the vicinity. Four people, including two police officers, were lightly injured, but luckily no one died. Following the close brush, Major had two guardhouses added to the gates in Downing Street, each manned by armed police. These officers were provided by the Metropolitan Police Diplomatic Protection Group, today called the Parliamentary and Diplomatic Protection Branch. This special unit works in close cooperation with MI5, the UK's domestic intelligence agency. Clearly, these guys are a well-trained professional force. to be reckoned with. But in recent years, they have not been free from controversy. In June 2011, serial burglar Obadiah Marius and his girlfriend Victoria Smith easily cleared the checks at the guardhouses by flashing what officers believed to be a building pass. It was later revealed that the security badge was simply Victoria's Lithuanian ID card. The two lovebirds wandered undisturbed into the cabinet room and other highly sensitive offices. They were finally intercepted by security inside the Privy Council's office, where they stated they were simply looking for work. Was Marius after an easy paycheck, or was he involved in something more sinister? Well, according to his lawyer, Harry Potter, yes, that is his real name, these are embarrassing offenses, but they are not espionage, but opportunist crime. In the ensuing trial, Marius avoided imprisonment and was suitable for residential rehabilitation requirements. I guess that got him out of Azkaban. On September the 19th, 2012, the security officers were embroiled in another controversy. Not because of incompetence, but due to excessive zeal. Policemen at one of the guardhouses challenged Chief Whip Andrew Mitchell as he cycled through one of the gates. The Chief Whip is a senior member of Parliament tasked with imposing discipline amongst party members and ensuring that they vote according to an established agenda. As a stickler for discipline, he should have known that the gates could be only cleared on foot, but on this occasion, he contested the rule, rowing with security staff and allegedly addressing them as plebs. Hence the name of the scandal, Plebgate, or Gategate. Mitchell denied using the word pleb, but following intense coverage of the incident, he eventually resigned. Afterwards, three police officers came under investigation for leaking information about the incident to the press. One of them, Constable Keith Wallace, was even sentenced to 12 months for providing false testimony. The complicated debacle dragged on until November 2014, when Andrew Mitchell sued for libel the News Group newspapers for their coverage of the event. On November the 27th, Mr. Justice Mitting ruled against Mitchell, claiming that the former whip had indeed used the word pleb. At the time of writing this episode, media coverage of Downing Street is primarily focused on the high turnover of new prime ministers settling into its premises. Every PM first moving into number 10 has barely a minute to celebrate, as the first days on the job are taken up by an intense induction. Following general elections, the leader of the winning party is summoned by the British monarch to Buckingham Palace. There, they will be welcomed by the Lord Chamberlain and escorted to a private audience with the monarch. As of today, that's King Charles III. After an initial exchange, the king bestows a formal appointment on the party leader, asking them to form a government in his name. The newly appointed PM is then escorted to Buckingham Palace's courtyard, where an official vehicle will drive them to number 10. The new PM then delivers a speech, laying out the broad strokes of the new administration's policies. Traditionally, a crowd of mostly reporters is in attendance, but depending on the historical situation, new PMs may expect hecklers to spice up proceedings. Former PM Gordon Brown expected anti-Iraq protesters to attend his inauguration speech. In preparation, he rehearsed by asking two close aides to shower him with abuse. After the speech, the PM walks through the entrance store, where aides and civil servants will deliver a welcoming applause. Next, the PM is expected to set immediately to work by enduring an endless barrage of briefings on living arrangements, security, and working with the cabinet. Then it will be time to address urgent decisions left pending by the previous administration. Once these steps are all cleared, the PM has to meet with a senior naval officer for a matter of utmost importance, the letters of last resort. The UK maintains a squadron of four Vanguard class submarines armed with Trident nuclear ballistic missiles. These vessels permanently roam the high seas, ready to strike back at the foes of old Blighty. The letters of last resort provide instructions to the commanders of the subs on what to do should the UK be targeted with atomic weapons and all communications are cut off. The contents of those letters are secret, but according to BBC's Radio 4, they usually contain one of four options: strike back, do nothing, use your own judgment, or place the submarine under the command of an allied country. This last option may be presented with a variant: put your submarine under the command of the United States, if they still exist. After drafting these letters, the PM will then securely seal them and hand them over to the naval officer. Once these terrifying decisions are taken, the PM will have to appoint their staff. First, non-political aides, and then the cabinet itself. Typically, the six most senior ministers will be in place by the end of the first day in office. These include the Defence, Home Justice, Foreign Affairs, and Health Secretaries, as well as the Lord Chancellor of the Exchequer. The latter is in charge of His Majesty's Treasury and traditionally resides at number 11. Once the groundwork has been laid, the overworked PM will have to stock up on some strong coffee and dive deep into operational decisions. For example, they will have to decide where, how, and how often to conduct regular meetings with civil servants and ministerial staff, as well as lay out the structure of key cabinet committees, which will be in charge of devising new policies and bills. And all this on the first day of the job. Lady Walpole, wife to the first occupant, Sir Robert, first entertained several high-profile guests in Downing Street, organizing lavish dinners in the present-day Terracotta Room. Their frequent guest, Queen Caroline, rubbed elbows with politicians, writers, and officers. Decades later, 12th Prime Minister Lord North organized a memorable dinner party on June 7, 1780. While his guests gorged on roast and fine wine, riots broke out on the streets of London. Known as the Gordon Riots, they opposed North's policies, allowing Catholics to join the military. The dinner party was interrupted by the threat of a raucous mob outside Number 10. As the Grenadier Guards barely held off the rioters, North stood up from the dining table and walked outside, warning the protesters that they risked getting shot. The mob duly dispersed, and North's guests climbed on top of Number 10 to admire the spectacle of riot fires blazing across London. For another memorable event, we must skip ahead a couple of centuries. Fresh from his landslide election, Labour PM Tony Blair threw what became known as the Cool Britannia Party on the 30th of July 1997. This was an occasion to tie the enthusiasm sparked by New Labour with the best that British popular culture had to offer. Oasis lead guitarist Noel Gallagher was the top celeb in attendance and was photographed merrily chatting away to the PM and his wife Sherry. In later years, Gallagher admitted that showing up at Number 10 had been a mistake, as he reassessed Blair's New Labour as being Tories in disguise, i.e. a party carrying a conservative agenda that he did not support. But it sounds like Gallagher had fun nonetheless. The guitarist later revealed that during the party he graffitied a portrait of Margaret Thatcher. In even more recent times, Downing Street and the staff of PM Boris Johnson were at the center of a large scandal involving social gatherings at the height of the COVID-19 restrictions. Civil servant Sue Gray investigated the allegations, compiling a report of these happenings. The results of her inquiry resulted in the scandal known as Partygate. In May 2020, restrictions allowed members of a household to meet with just one person from another household and only outdoors. But on the 15th, Johnson met with 17 staff members in the Downing Street Gardens for a cheese and wine party. On the 20th, civil servant Martin Reynolds invited more than 100 staff for evening drinks. His invite email encouraged attendees to bring your own booze. The event did not escape the watchful eye of the Metropolitan Police, and several fines were issued. Clearly, the staff had not learned the lesson, as on June the 19th, they threw a birthday party for the PM in the Cabinet Room, which was attended by some 30 people, Johnson himself receiving a fine of £100. Lessons learned? Well, no. On November the 13th, two social events took place at Number 10, the first one in the press office area and the latter one in the PM's own flat. Boris Johnson was questioned in Parliament whether a party had occurred on that date, and his reply was, "No, but I am sure that whatever happens, the guidance was followed and the rules were followed at all times." Once again, the Met Police begged to disagree and dished out another barrage of fines. The second half of December was the season to be jolly for Number 10 staff. On the 15th, the PM himself hosted a Christmas quiz assisted by aides in Santa hats. The party itself took place on the 18th, a crowded event livened up by cheese and wine, as well as an exchange of secret Santa gifts. On April the 17th, 2021, the royal family and the nation mourned the death of Prince Philip at a socially distanced funeral. Queen Elizabeth could be seen sitting by herself in the church, her face covered by a surgical mask. And yet, the night before, Number 10 had hosted not one, but two events, described by the BBC as boozy. Libations dragged on until 4:20 the next morning. A member of staff volunteered to DJ while others were busy damaging a swing set in the garden. Boris Johnson did not attend the wild night, but he was aware of it taking place and later apologized for it. The Partygate scandal tarnished the PM's reputation and was quoted by the BBC as one of the key reasons which led to his resignation. This was segued by the short-lived premiership of Liz Truss, followed by Rishi Sunak taking office. We trust that he has properly sealed those letters of last resort and that he has left a saucer of milk for Larry in the garden. And that concludes our introduction to the history of Number 10, which I hope you found enjoyable. If you'd like to hear more stories of presidential palaces, ministerial mansions, and royal retreats, let us know in the comments below. And thanks for watching.